Hello everybody, welcome to the Quorum workshop series. My name is Julie Wilson and I'm president of the Edinburgh Architectural Association. We are running a series of monthly practice-led workshops, and we held a larger workshop in November last year looking at the RIS strategy moving forward into the future. And from that workshop there were some very clear themes which emerged which were of concern to the people that attended of particular interest. So the Quorum series has really come out of that so that we can take each of those themes which came out of the November event and look at them in a more focused way. So far we've had two workshops. We had one in March on public procurement, we had another one in April on representation, and this is our third event on communication. And there are other workshops planned for later this year. The next one, just being hosted by Dermot here from LDN Architects, is going to be in structure and governance, and that's in June, and we'll be advertising that shortly to you all, so you can book tickets if you want to come along to that one. I think that's probably
Thank you very much. Okay. So as Julie said, communication was one of the themes that came up in the November workshop. It's quite a complicated topic, basically runs through everything that the RIS does, every aspect, which includes governance and their transparency issues. And I'm sure that most of the workshops in the series will touch on communication in some aspect. But we really want to take a step back from that a little bit tonight, not really dissect the internal communication of the RIS, but look at it in three ways, which is image, information, and outreach. And to explore this further, we'd like to welcome our three speakers. Thank you very much for taking your time to come along this evening, Gail, Astrid, and Andy. A couple of things before we start tonight. There's a couple of housekeeping items. Fire exits up the stairs. There's one here. There's one in the next office through that door there. If you go upstairs, there's two exits to the front. One's a push bar. One's on a thumb turn lock. There's also an exit to the rear, which has got a key in the door. Just turn the key and you go out to a lovely garden. Hopefully we won't need that, but just in case. The main meeting point is actually at the front, which is by Coulter's on the corner of Marchmont Crescent. Facilities, the toilets are just on the door on the right there, behind Helen. And there's refreshments, as you saw upstairs, if you need anything or want anything during the talks, maybe hold up a hand, I could probably run up and get you something. The first two speakers are Gail and Astrid, where I'm actually wanting to introduce them together. There's a slight change in programme as their themes kind of overlap, so we thought they would run one after the other and then we'll do a Q&A at the end, because otherwise we'd end up crossing topics a little bit too much. Gail is an incredibly enthusiastic graphic designer and director of Gail Turpin Design. She's worked with global brands such as Carlsberg, Toblerone, alongside high street icons including Boots and The Body Shop. Gail's actually now based in Edinburgh and works with a diverse range of clients. I have to admit, she did work on the HLA website with Astrid, so I have to hold our hands up to that. But works with kind of large companies, startups, everything in between. She's got an incredible eye for colour and detail, and we're very pleased to have you here this evening, obviously. And our second speaker is Astrid Johnson. She's a website designer and information curator by proxy, which hopefully will make sense soon. She works regularly with Gail and also worked on our website. She's director of Ast and Red, which is based in Edinburgh and Cambridge, and worked on very prestigious websites, various scales, and has great skill for helping companies prioritise and kind of distill information for communication purposes, which we thought would be strong to speak about tonight. So welcome, thank you very much, and I'll let you guys take it away.
Thank you.
Don't clap for me.
I've got an incredible eye for colour
and one grey and white.
Thanks, Christina, and thank you for asking us along today. I'm going to start with this quote. I'm actually not even going to talk about this. I'm just going to leave it there for you to ponder, and I'll come back to it later on. It's something I found recently, and I thought it was quite useful. Just a little bit about me. I trained in visual communication, graphic design, Edinburgh College of Art, worked in London for 15 years, Amsterdam for 2 years, before coming back to Edinburgh. Graphic design then, I specialised in branding and packaging, and at that time, what happened after that was leaflets and brochures, and nobody really does that anymore. Number one marketing tool is always a website now. It's what everybody wants and says that they want. I didn't expect to get involved in website design, and actually my first experience in working in websites was actually a very tricky one, because you will all relate to this. I was used to being able to do it myself. But when you're a designer and my life is never going to be long enough to learn how to write code. So I'm dependent on a builder, and I'm dependent on trying to relay what I want to that builder. And I feel like I've got my hands tied behind my back and boxing gloves on. I can't, you know, it's not that. It's very, very difficult, and I'm sure you completely relate to that. Then I met Astrid and Jai, Aston Red. And we realised we kind of spoke the same language, and we started to work together. And the way we work is, I'm the design side. There's Jai, which is, he's the builder, he writes the code and does all of that stuff, which I don't really understand. And then Astrid is in the middle, and she joins everything together. And Astrid will talk about that, but actually it's kind of interesting what has happened, because we do overlap quite a lot. You know, we do go back and forward between each other quite a lot. And again, we can hopefully explain a bit. You can ask me more later, but we can explain a bit more about that later. So websites are a natural progression from branding now. I always feel that the world is not waiting with bated breath for another new logo. And I think sometimes people will think if they have a logo, then they've done the whole job. And it sits at the top right, and that's where you always put it, and it's almost that colour. But it's such a small part of who you are. You know, it's about the style of photography, and it's about colour and layout and style of illustration and the pace, and you know, it's the whole DNA of who you are, and it's keeping that consistent. We have clients coming to us and they say, oh, we need a website. Need a website, and we'll say, well, why do you need a website? What do you want to say? How do you want to present yourself? And as Christina said, we designed and built Helen's website, and before we got started on that, we talked a lot with Helen and her team, and we looked at lots of architect sites, and of course there, like all sectors, there's a language. Before I talk about that, one of my bugbears in packaging is the language of environmentally friendly products which you buy. They always have to be kind of quiet and polite, and it's a little creepy. You know, they always kind of behave themselves, and that bugs me. I could talk at length about that as well, but I won't talk about that. But when we started looking at Health Site, we looked at lots of architect sites, and of course we found lots of white space, and we didn't find very much colour. And actually we thought that some of them were maybe intentionally a little bit intimidating. Speaking to Helen and her team, we asked, you know, who are you communicating to? Are you communicating to other architects? Are you communicating to your clients? Who are your clients? Who do you want your clients to be? It's very hard to talk about yourself and communicate clearly who you are and what you do. And absolutely, by far, our most successful clients are the ones who take the time to do that and are happy to let us probe and let us in to ask the questions, because we all have blind spots. Of course we do, we all do. So Helen, this is an early visual. Helen, they've been very, very good at recording jobs, there was a, we had a fantastic, when I asked Helen, you know, have you recorded all of your projects, and she'd had wonderful photographers go and record, so we had this amazing gallery of shots to work with. And so that was, it was important to show that and to be able to then go on and see it on a larger scale, so you can flick through the large images. But you can navigate visually, so we wanted it to be quite like an interiors magazine, and for people to really browse and feel comfortable browsing. We use colour. We know from the analytics that people do spend a lot of time, and people really do browse and look around this. This is an early visual showing how spacing of things happen. So, as I say, larger images are, could be flipped through too.
Before I leave this, I don't know, I actually forgot to ask you if you're right when saying this, but I'll say it anyway, you can hit me afterwards.
Yes.
A couple of months after we finished and the site was live, Helen phoned me up and she said, Gail, this is going to sound really mad, but do you think we could take the site down for a couple of months? I thought, why? She said, because we just can't cope with the number of people that are calling. And we decided that you just kind of slip on it and decided not to stick it down. Am I going to be hit after? So as a contrast to Helen's site, I've decided to Helen's look and branding, I thought I'd show you something that it couldn't be any more different, really. There's a client that we have up in Shetland who's a knitwear designer, and she phoned up. She used to be a
Criminal defence lawyer.
She went to Shetland to do a textile course and didn't leave, and is now a knitwear designer. And so she phoned up and she showed me this is what she had. And we went to see her. So we went to see her, and this is what she had. We flew up there, and Astrid and I, we just could not believe what we were seeing. The most exquisite quality merino contemporary Shetland knitwear. It wasn't as you imagined Shetland to be. I mean, the stuff was absolutely exceptional. I mean, she was seriously underselling herself. So we took a lot of shots. This is Astrid wearing one of these. And there was all this fantastic Shetland buildings. It was all there. It was just there. It was a gift. And it was wonderful. So, and part of the reason I'm showing this is, you know, it's absolute opposite of white space. In order to take it further, I asked Mila if I could come into a studio with her and could I see her sketchbooks. And these are some photographs that I took from things that she had in her sketchbooks. And that basically informed everything that I did. Again, I could show you loads and loads of groups that we did. You know, from here to this. This is where we ended up. Kind of she was more comfortable with the type being reminiscent of where she was, but this large end which we use on everything goes through the website and all of her material. So it was then the logo was established and we went with a photographer. The clothes can every age group, young, old, big, small, and we got normal women from all over the island to model, and we had shots taken of the buildings, the rocks, you know, again, could show loads and loads, but the colour and texture was the main thing. The tags, these are hand silk screen printed onto really beautiful, you can't tell from there, but really fabulous quality card. And then the other one is much kind of a little bit more austere and a bit more serious, so even the tags are you know, different feel. So when it came to her website, this is an early visual, no white space anywhere, scribble, layering, and navigation, which was very complex. Astrid is going to get into that later on. Even things like when we were having shots of people wearing the clothes, normally we would stand with a photographer and we'd lay out the perfect white sheet and everybody would be standing and you wouldn't crush that white sheet. Astrid and I were rolling around on this paper, crushing it up and tearing things. We wanted texture everywhere. So she started off with selling to cruise liners when they came in. And now she is selling, she's just showing at the Saatchi Gallery. I don't know if the exhibition's finished, but the Crafts Council were showing her work at the Saatchi Gallery recently, and she's selling all over the world. And it's been completely transformative for her. These are just screen grabs from her website. And just show you, don't sometimes even end up behind the camera as well. So we asked Neela before today if she would be okay us showing this work. And she sent this message this morning. She said, good luck both for your talk. Remember to mention how much I resisted the change. I had no real direction, but the branding has given me parameters within which I can work more easily. It's given me structure. So if I just go back, before I finish, I'll go back to the first quote. We're all bombarded every day by texts and emails and websites, and it has become very, very easy for us to communicate, but we still really need to take time to think about what the message is. That's it.
Hi, thanks to the Edinburgh Architectural Association and to Helen Lucas Architects for hosting us and to Christina for sorting us all out. I'm going to talk about how you can use structure and language in your communications and particularly in your website to get across what you want to say to visitors to the site. I work at Aston Red, as Gail said. One of my jobs is information architect, so I sit between Gail, the designer, and the developer and make sure that they don't fall out with each other, although I'm not a miracle worker. I work on the structure of the website, I look at the architecture of it, what content is going to go into that structure, and then how on earth users are going to navigate into that structure and find the content that they want. And obviously with a website, you don't know which direction people are going to come into. You can't guarantee they're going to come in on the front page, so that adds a whole kind of extra dimension of fun. These sort of skills and approaches that I use are just the same as you might use organising anything, cutlery, your library. It's all just really about clear thinking. I've also worked on publications, like complicated books of mine. But this is probably, for clients, the least enjoyable bit of the whole process, I would say. My colleagues would probably agree with me. Sometimes that's how I feel as well. And I completely loved this when I saw it, that this is Peter Morville, an information architect. Before this term, information architect, was coined, he called it the pain with no name, which is pretty right. I'm delighted to be here speaking to architects because I'm going to be talking about like really granular, boring detail, and I know I'll be speaking to the preaching to the converted. We start at the beginning of the job, really, as Gail said, asking a lot of why type questions. Why are we building this website? What is its purpose? And that definitely gets rolled into who the business or organisation or the person are in terms of their what they're projecting. Who is it for? And that might be more than one audience. And what do we want to achieve? And we have to kind of keep revisiting this all the way through the pain doesn't unfortunately end at the beginning when we move on to the nice, glamorous, visual bit of the job. We're constantly looking at that all the way through, and in fact, you should be going back and looking at that even once the site's launched. Just keep reevaluating it. It's not going to be perfect the first time. You can really try and get it as good as it can be, but you are going to have to keep coming back. Just like anything, the business might change a little bit, or you know, something interesting might happen that you need to refocus. I'm going to jump into looking at a case study, if I can get this to work. Since we're here.
Sorry, everybody.
I know. we built this site with Helen and her team and with Gail about 5 years ago. The why on this job was, the answer to that in kind of most basic sense was Helen had a pretty decent website, but it was just beginning to strain at the seams with the amount of content that needed to go into it. The content had outgrown the website. The navigation was therefore creaking a little bit, and also browsers had just moved on, and we could now show a lot more lovely big images, so this was just a really good opportunity to get into that great archive that they've invested a lot in and get people's eyes on it. So like many of our clients, in some senses HLA, when we came to work with them, were underselling themselves, or they weren't talking about all the really interesting stuff that they do and really giving a good account of themselves. So on this site I'm going to look at just two like small examples of how structure and language can be really useful in the whole brand, for want of a better word, and the whole message. The first thing is this materials and detailing. So when we were talking to Helen and her team, and it's really important to us that it's not just the people at the top of the organisation that are involved in this, you need several different voices. Things that came out of something that they felt really passionate about and that was important was their use of materials, and particularly use of timber. Now, we were thinking, oh, where can that go? Classic information architecture, oh, is it going to go on each page? And we thought, no, let's put it right up at the top. And it's on a par with living spaces, workspaces, let's put it there. And part of the reason for doing that is, again, to do with audience. Now, you lot will look at these pictures and you will see use of timber and all sorts of other things. But many of Helen's clients are not architecturally literate. They might look and go, that's nice, but they don't know what's in that picture actually if you ask them to describe it. So we are saying, literally, we like materials and detailing, and we've put that up there. So that's thinking about the kind of client that might be coming to look at this site. The second thing I want to look at is about language, use of language. And this is kind of pivoting between different audiences. Helen and her team had already started going down the route of departing from traditional ways of describing their work. So in the previous site, their navigation said living and working when you were looking at the projects. So that's going away from the kind of more weighty residential and commercial, which is what you would expect to see. So they'd already gone down that route. I felt that living and working were maybe a little bit too abstract as words, and I wanted to introduce the idea of buildings and space and solidity back into them. So we ended up, again, I actually can't remember whose idea that was. It was all part of the discussion to be living spaces and workspaces. So that shows their intention. As Gail was saying, we wanted to make this really nice and approachable. Many of the clients, as I said, are coming to it, are not architecturally literate. They're private clients. They're going to be inviting you into their home to make a home for them, potentially. So this sets the tone for the whole site, and it's part of everything. You know, this is just a small detail. It's part of everything that we're kind of looking at here. And that gives you an idea of the kind of really nitpicky, granular stuff that I'll be looking at, that kind of wording. But the other thing is that this site is not only aimed at clients. We have to be realistic about that. We actually worked with a couple of architects, and we try to get people to suspend a little bit thinking about what their peers are going to think and focus for a while on the clients themselves. But this does also need to speak to the architectural community of which HLA is part. And it needs to be serious in that sense. But it also needs to attract good staff to come here and to stay here. And we felt that using words like living spaces and workspaces just straight, you know, before you've clicked on anything, tells architects how Helen and her team feel about their work. Now, those words are not going to be appropriate for everybody here in this room working in different practices, but those were appropriate to this job. And that's why it was interesting that actually that route came from what Helen and the team already had, and we've just refined it slightly and actually kind of blown that whole idea across the website. So that's just two tiny wee examples about language and structure. I'm also going to look at, actually there's the living, working, that's the old site from the Wayback Machine, missing its image in the middle. This is a different side of the same coin that Dale's been talking about. This actually is the impact that information architecture has had on this job is far bigger in some senses, because it's had really quite a profound impact on the way that Neela, the designer, works and runs her business. We asked a lot of annoying questions about how she was doing things, but we also had to get onto a really annoying level of detail, because this is also a shop, it's not just a brochure. She does things like, she makes one style of jumper and it will be available in, I'm not joking, 75 colours at once. How do you deal with that? Well, you start to ask, should there be 75 colours, really? And this has been an ongoing conversation, but Neela's philosophy in life is more is more. She says that herself, it's brilliant. So we had to cope with that, we had to cope with the 75 colours, but I was also like, that's just crazy. So over the last couple of years, that whole thing, and that's just one small example of it, has really fed actually into what she's doing, and she has streamlined what she's doing. The new collections like this one, that's only available in one colourway, one, and it's not just black and white. And it's driven sales because it's so much more efficient to deal with on every administrative level and selling in the shop and all kinds of things. So that has been really, really interesting to see. The other aspect on this, again, this is a language thing. If we look here, this collection was previously called Elephant's Ear. It's now called Marlet, which is the Shetland word for mottled. Now, this collection, Rig, was called Crocodile. I just couldn't bear it when I was looking at these things, when I was looking at this level, because I spend a lot of time looking at a white page with black type on it, working out where things are going to go. And it just distracted me so much, because I was thinking about elephants when I was looking at Shetland knitwear. It was just mad. So the elephant is part of the story. She does a wrap that is the shape of an elephant's ear. And we do talk about that. We're not trying to push people into things that they're not. It's not like some horrible branding exercise where you're talking rubbish about something. It was just refocusing it so that people could access it, because her stuff is really sophisticated and confusing, and you have to let people navigate into it easily. So we did persuade her that it was a good idea and worked with our brilliant copywriter to come up with some new names. And again, interestingly, her new collections, they have a name that speaks about the collection much more clearly from the beginning. So those are kind of two very small, but actually quite, they're not inconsequential. They've really changed the way that, that she works. And I'm not just talking about the website, I'm actually talking about the whole organisation and structure. So just to come back to the beginning, if I can get this to structure and language, I think, are a really key part of the website and your general communication strategy. And I hope those examples have shown you how much they can really help you telling your audience what you want to say. Thanks.
I think this is probably quite a good moment, and we'll jump in before you pull up and
oh,
should leave that
maybe
up.
Get the RIS website.
Not to be super controversial.
Does anyone want me to bring any drinks, Tim?
Yeah, I was also going to say, if you want a quick beverage break.
Or run out, don't be frowned upon.
Hands up
go
for
and beer.
Who wants a beer?
One, two, three. Three beers? How many wines?
One, two, four, five.
Are they all red?
That's it, it's over. What
is this?
Can you do
Sandwiches here as well, if anyone would like to pass to them.
Sandwich?
Come on.
Website, because when we started talking to Gail and Astrid about speaking tonight, it was very clear looking at this website that it started off with good intention, and unfortunately it's been layered upon and layered upon with information to the point where it's unnavigable. I feel quite confident saying that. So
a lot of rubbish in there.
And I think it's because it's not gone through a process of refinement, and I think there's a lot of overlap, which I'm sure we could get into with regards to how that stretches, you know, maybe across the RIS, but that's really, it's not really what tonight's about. It's more to try and get to the nitty-gritty of, you know, as a face for the RIS, which is what the website is, which is, you know, the message that Gail and Astrid kind of put across, the importance of that and the power that can have. This is a public interface, it's a practice interface, it's an architectural interface. I go there for resources, I did as a student, you know. It's more about a gathering of ideas of the priorities of that and what Gail and Astrid has said and how that can be applied. Is it a logo redesign, and kind of to get everyone's ideas on that, and also in turn to ask questions of Gail and Astrid to maybe, you know, how that could be improved. I don't know if anyone's got any questions or ideas.
I kind of feel a little bit like sometimes when I look at sites like this, that if you imagine that you have a ring binder and you've put it in the office and you said to everybody, right, just put all your information that you really need to see in here, and everybody chucks it in, and they, and then you almost can't even bear to open it because you can't find anything. It actually you know, makes you go, oh, can't you? And you know that people are just, they're going to spend 3 seconds and then they're going to leave because they're going to think this is just too hard.
Yeah.
And it's not helpful.
And I know you've talked about logos not being very important, but this logo, I feel, really speaks of another age.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it doesn't belong on a website either.
No,
you know?
I mean, I don't think they're not important. I think they're very important, but I think that the mistake that can be made is that people can think, right, what we need a new logo, and we get a new logo, and you get these to pay a fortune for the guidelines, and they tell you what to do with it and what not to do with it, and what space you have to have around it, and you put it here and go. But to be honest, it's not, that isn't really, as I can say, it's the whole thing, it's the DNA. It's, I mean, there are companies like UPS, you know, the parcel service, they have with their corporate guidelines, and they even go to the length of telling their delivery drivers that whenever they go in somewhere, they have to go fast. You know, they don't go in like the wrong way, all kind of scratching the backside and moves up to, you know, they're kind of, it's all, and that is the, sorry, is that still being recorded? Sorry, wrong way.
We love our postman.
But, yeah. I designed the Parcel Force logo. Anyway, but I think it is that it's being aware of everything that you do and every, you know, every bit of communication and being a kind of united front and what that is.
I mean, it's interesting in the examples that you both showed. It was very, you know, the transformation was imagery. And I like to think we produce beautiful buildings.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no imagery.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you have to almost find it. You've got to work quite hard to find it. And I mean, there's a whole informatics exercise with regards to distillation of information. And I think it runs probably within the priorities as well of what the RIS want to focus on and the information they want to get across. So it intertwines, but it's interesting that, you know, the logo change isn't the root.
I mean,
I haven't worked for years. I'm retired.
That's why you look so relaxed.
but I still read a lot about architecture and my UJ and all the rest of it. And it's clear to me that architects are being lost in the fog. You know, they do wonderful work, and they do all sorts of things that are amazing. But most people don't actually realise that. And you open this website, and it's a load of rubbish. It doesn't tell you anything really about what an architect does. It doesn't tell you how important they are. It doesn't actually tell you even how to think about getting an architect. It's useless. It's a useless website.
And it's got this fortress on the front of it. It says,
it's
not welcome here.
And it's interesting, because I got my wife to open it and have a look at it. And she really couldn't make her way around it at all. It's just a load of rubbish.
It has no presence.
And if the incorporation is going to advance the cause of architects in Scotland, this is not the way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So don't even let this cancer just go away and start again.
Bell and Astridgen.
The RIBA one is better.
It is better.
Because actually, I think like the navigation actually invited me in as a non-architect. Working with an architect,
yeah.
I think.
Well, it's got pictures on it, that helps.
It's
yeah, working with an
historic.
Architect.
It's still not great.
And it's still quite dry. It's quite dry, but at
yeah.
least it doesn't, as you say, have a barrier to entry.
Yeah, there's another thing in there that if you're a kid, you know,
yeah.
like when I was thinking about being an architect,
yeah.
and looked, well, why would I be an architect? There's nothing in there.
Well,
there.
Even
yeah.
is an architect, you'd
yeah,
be asking.
Yeah,
yeah,
but there's nothing. You know, why would I want to be an architect? Well, it should be in the website.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think until now, everybody's been incredibly polite about the RIS website,
yeah.
but presumably for all architects, we'll know how to mark up drawings, and if you're going to
mark up the website, it would be
tear up the website.
So, but we all probably know it's going to have to come from absolute structural renewal from within, because we're not actually the client for the new RIS website, unless, of course, we all are paying our members and are going to then engineer the change from within. But I mean, I was actually looking at the RIB website today. If you scroll down, there's the equality, inclusion and diversity tab to click on, whole load of role models to look at. So, you know, it's structured entirely differently, and particularly in terms of drawing in people. So, I mean, it's like, where do you start? But they've had, I suppose, consultancy on top of consultancy in order to refresh each branch of that, and also funding to keep each branch of that constantly alive and refreshed, because that's the whole thing. You haven't mentioned who updates the websites that you make, so it's sort of the websites in action and the life cycle of them, which
and you can have a website you can have a website which will start off looking fabulous, you know, and then of course you have to be able to update it, and you have to, when we finish with clients, we actually do want them to go away, because we don't really get involved in kind of maintenance, but you can very quickly take a site which the day before looked amazing. Somebody can just crop some other pictures, use some different pictures, I'm just talking visually, you can change, you can make that look terrible very quickly without somebody looking after it and curating it and making sure it's doing what it wants to say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think the sustainability of it is important, and we always think about that when we're designing things. Mm. Like, obviously we can make it look great, but it's got to be easy to update, and it's really good if somebody within the organisation takes ownership of it, and we'll do quite a bit of training on that. But it does come down to time and who the person is in the end, and it is an issue, especially with something like the RIS website, like who's actually going to do that, because there's tons of information in there.
And now there are lots of people putting things in the folder.
Yeah.
You will get the odd phone call.
What?
What's that doing
What's
there?
That? This is a typo on page.
You're probably sort of A star students though, your website. So imagine what it's like for other people.
Does anybody actually know when the RIAS website was the last updated? From the
1990.
But it'd be interesting to know if people have used the website, what they last used it for.
With the jobs page, you know, I think that's the most
If anyone was on the website, what did they last use?
And a lot of practice
services.
Apparently,
you can't search for things unless you have the exact number to put in.
Apparently, there's some very small practices. I'm a small practice and I can't understand this. That is what they use as their website, as their practice page on the RIS.
You are
joking. So I've been told.
we need to sort out the RIS website,
then it needs to be graphically better for them, because that's their web presence. And you have to pay an extra fee to have your practice on the RIS website as well.
So in what way is that their web presence?
They don't have a website.
I understand, but in what way are they represented?
If you pay, you go to the list and their practice will be in there, and they can then have a link.
It's the chat box,
Christine, we're going to type in. So yeah, they could have a link to their practice page on the RIS website, and this is one of the other issues, is that to try and be very fair to all the members,
and
they
have
a growing programme of images, but it means sometimes when you open up the RIS website, there's an industrial shed as the opening image, and in terms of promoting architecture in Scotland, sometimes you open up and you go, that's the opening image on the RIS.
Does anyone know what a chartered practice is?
That's a member of practice.
I see. So you pay the extra bit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not
bad. We've got that.
So there are two strands. One's architects and firms looking at this, but public proposing, there's no public, there's no human architect. The front page does not speak to the public at all.
No.
Doesn't speak to the architect section.
That sort of comes back to the sort of first two questions on the first of the second slides. What is it for and who is it speaking to? And you can sort of immediately tell from looking at this that neither of those questions is particularly clear in its answer. You know, is this fundamentally about it being a resource for architecture practices and it's in this kind of pseudo-union function kind of helping us do our job, or is it about advocacy and speaking to the wider public?
Yeah.
And it's doing neither particularly well, you know, and in some ways they might actually be two separate websites.
Mm-hmm.
The kind of functional thing that we might use to access a practice node
could
actually be quite separate.
I mean, even the domain name, I remember when RIBA bought architecture.com because it was in the papers, they paid £4 billion to get architecture.com or whatever it was. So, you know, now it doesn't, it could be .scot, it could be .com, it could be, you know, it could be something which is, so there's
because
honestly
there's an insurance, I think it's like the something insurance association.
Yeah.
If you type in RIS,
yes,
it
comes up first on
Google
search.
It's
incredible.
It's an insurance website that comes up first. So. But even if you're a member of the public going on to get to that page, why use a chartered architect? You have to go through a tab saying services,
yes,
which doesn't immediately direct you to that's the place to go if
to
find out about
it.
Also,
to look at the statistics, what's
going
to be in public rank?
Look where. Yeah, Reba said working with an architect is one of the first things you see when you come on.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So here I've got services, but I think that's professional services. I've got directory, but the thing that's going to get the most hits is this one.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe followed by this one. But there's an awful lot of ding-ding-ding-ding-ding-ding.
But by the time you get
to
them, there's all members.
Yeah. The chapter is at last.
But I think the thing is it's working very, it's trying to do a huge amount.
I'm looking at this going.
But
it gives me a headache too.
It's a headache to work it out.
Mm.
To actually get to the point where you have something that's working is like what I was, it's the pain with no name. This is a really good example because you're talking to lots of different people and there's lots of different things that need to be communicated.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there's an argument for splitting it so that you would have a directory as a separate website?
Possibly.
And you'd just have a link to that
You could, as I'm talking totally off the top of my head, but you could, if you,
yeah,
you
so
could
not,
call it like
it.
Architecture, you know, you could do something which was like Architecture Scotland. And that was, or something, I don't know.
Could you sort out the first question, which is, are you an architect or?
Yeah,
or
you
looking
could
for
have,
an architect.
You could have a landing page
and then
that
sends
splits,
you, yeah.
Yes.
Or you could have two completely separate sites. I mean, you see that kind of split thing quite often when it's like big companies and they have different territories.
Yeah.
Where are you? Thing, and then you don't see the US stuff or whatever.
Where are you
retail?
Who are you?
Yeah. I think it's interesting that, you know, benefits of using an architect versus why use an architect, going into the nitty gritty.
Mm.
I mean, you might ask, why use an architect? And they're like, oh,
yeah,
save myself
sarcastic
some money.
Question.
Why should I use an architect? Maybe they don't.
Are you sure you want to use an architect?
Absolutely.
Refer you to the surveillance website, which is a whole lot better.
Yeah, don't you really want to go on holiday?
I think that's something that Aspen really made me aware of with regards to the vocabulary and the choice of word. It's so sensitive. And I mean, we are getting into the nitty-gritty. We are probably the most analytical audience, but I think it's really key to, this should be an advertisement in a way, for me personally.
Mm-hmm. Well, it should also be something that you're proud of, that you're happy to, you know, because you can tell that everybody in this room is cringing about it.
I mean, there's a huge amount, I mean, it's obviously started at some point, there's a huge amount of work going in, and I think, as someone mentioned, there's a lot happening behind the scenes that needs to feed in from, in a kind of strategy perspective, but I think from an information point of view, it's interesting the things that people have brought up with regards to, almost without realising it, what you would want from it or what it would bring to the profession. There's a few key points that have come up, which are really interesting. And I think
it's the platform for which the RIS is viewed by everyone in the world who wants to know what it's doing. And I think that probably feeds us in quite nicely to what Andy's doing as being the voice of architecture. wait for my intro.
You could surely have a website that you know is an advert, but that you have a bit that is the membership section. So then you can go into directories and whatever you like. But I think there needs to be something that explains how wonderful we all are. And it's not
the public face of architecture.
No. Yes.
Need some pictures of human beings so people will know who they are.
Yeah.
A lot of people will say that the practice notes and a lot of the background stuff that the RIAS do so it has to be ring fenced and maintained.
Practice services is brilliant.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but that's fine.
I'm agreeing.
You can almost separate it out from the public interface, is what you're saying. Essentially, if you're a member and you log in,
I do think practice services needs to be redesigned too, though.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not
the look of the information.
Oh.
I mean,
the look, but actually, what it does.
No, what it does is fantastic. The information is fantastic, but it could be a little bit more handsome.
Everything that our pen should do should.
Yes. Just keep holding on.
But I think the domain name, it's a really good point, because I wonder in the wider public, you know, does RIS mean anything?
Nothing.
To
no.
No. So it doesn't, it's totally abstract. We know what it is, but fundamentally.
Yeah, members,
Yeah. It, you know, I speak to other consultants who don't actually recognise it as a, well, recognise, you know, in terms of the name.
Mm.
Immediately, so even within the industry, it's not necessarily known by everyone. Which is
just because that's what the heading of the website is doesn't mean that's what you need to Google.
In the way that the RIBA have done, I know they've got kind of a sort of wider presence in the way just by sheer numbers, but they've kind of defined themselves as a brand. I'm not saying it's perfect, so it's got some faults, but there's a recognition of what that means, I think.
Is it controversial to suggest that Scotland is just a chapter, like the North West, for the website visits?
Well, that is what happens on the RIBA website.
But then
I'd say that's controversial.
I would think that we could have a website that's better than the RIBA website, and how good would that be? You know, to have,
like,
you know,
let's
have
do
the
it.
Best architecture website anywhere, because it's a worldwide stage. You know, why can someone here?
You just need
Gail
and Astrid on it.
Yeah.
That's
what I'm saying. But the RIBA website does throw the gauntlet down, because you get, you know, RIBA in, you know, London, and the chapters in Wales, and the international.
Mm-hmm.
But that's almost their problem.
Apart from so in fact, the coast is clear
for it to be
much more common.
Mm.
But certainly, they would need to, you know, all this discussion is great, because that's, you know, that's what's needed to, you know, because they'll not all agree, and they'll be, but it's that that's needed, which is what, you know, what we've been saying really.
There's a field of coffee to walk through before you get there.
It's okay.
What was that? A field of coffee to
roll
through. Sounds brilliant.
Yeah, that's why everyone wants to walk through a field of toffee.
Quite like toffee. Yeah. Is it Highland toffee?
That'll be hard.
One of those wee hammers.
Yeah. I think that RIBA handles the image of you know, their logo was, you know, being a really old profession, you know, grounded, with the new very well. You know, they've got the Rampant Lions logo, which has been there for yonks, yeah, but it's sort of on the logo at the top with RIBA, and it's
had changed and changed and changed, and it had become something like Land Rover or something, a snowdrop, and a green oval, and they said themselves, they said, you know, we're not recognisable even to ourselves. And so I went there, and it's this incredible, you know, country house on the estate, and just walked around with them, and there was this wonderful shield, and they had the family, it was been with the family, you know, since
1668.
So I said, well, let's just
let us go back, and they're very proud of, you know, how long this had been there, and it was still in the family. Yeah, and so I thought, well, I used to do a lot of work for Boots, and I've been in Boots, been in many meetings where it's been noted that, you know, we need to change the logo, we need to update the logo, and I've been sitting there going, no, leave it alone, just leave it alone, you know. but I think here they needed to go back a wee bit and to re-establish themselves, because people, often people are trying to infer, you know, we're, you know, we have heritage, they're trying to infer heritage, and they have it in Shedlows, but they weren't talking about it. So I did this, and it's kind of re-established them with kind of much more sort of gravitas.
But that's like how you can like address some kind of emblem like that, and the dates and things, and something historic, but then if you
but
go
still
through,
feel,
but
still
feel
contemporary.
Current.
Still
yeah.
feel contemporary, mm-hmm. because I don't think that looks, you know, it still has the heritage, but it doesn't look.
I think to be fair, just for a minute to the RIS, what actually happened, because I was on the council when this all happened, and what happened was Neil became the secretary, and you know, he stepped into an organisation that was in a shambles, like it is now, but it was in a shambles, and he had quite a difficult job to grab things and fix them. Like, there was an idea that they would leave the office, that you know, they would change the office and they would go and build something else, and Andy Doolan was going to finance that, but of course he died, you know, and everything was a shambles, and would we stay in the office? And at the same time, before that, Mary Wren had been the secretary, and she wanted to throw all this away, quite right.
Mm-hmm.
But it hadn't been done. And by the time that Neil came along, he slightly desperately, I think, sort of grabbed it and thought, well, there's a fantastic credit, we'll just keep that. And then the John Jardine chap, I think it was him, I'm not sure, but somebody stepped in and began to do a bit of graphics and things. And I think people thought, ah, that'll do just now.
Yeah.
And it's just
it's
gone on for too long.
Yeah.
There's
a lack of investment, isn't it?
Well, that's the point. So you had a lot of dusty old guys, and there were quite a few of them on the council, who wouldn't spend the money to do it, or to make a website. Nobody was interested.
Well, I think generally
you know.
People don't see it as important.
No.
And I think, you know,
especially
what I'm saying
when you're
about
old and dusty. You know.
I think, but I think, you know, you'll know yourselves from, you know, designing buildings, is that, you know, the best work comes out of when you're working with people who know the value in good design, and they and they're with you on it. And if they can stay with you on it, then you're going to get, and it doesn't necessarily have to cost more money, it's just keeping the faith, you know. It
does help though.
The money's an interesting thing though, because the first quorum was on public procurement, and we were lamenting the lack of investment in design teams.
Yeah.
We can't expect to get much more out if we're not prepared to invest in design teams for products ourselves.
But I think, if you think about all the members, if there was like a poll of members, who would like to contribute to a better public face for architecture in Scotland, I think you would get, you know, like the book got quite a lot of people to invest.
I don't think about it.
You know, but a handsome amount of money went into the RIS for the purposes of making that book.
And then they gave them to everybody.
So there is finance there for things, you know, if it could be seen to be producing something that would elevate us as a profession.
I think it's almost essential if small practices are relying on this
exactly.
as their public or web presence
yeah.
for their business,
mm-hmm.
And paying
extra.
To have
extra for that,
then if that's all that they're getting for their money, then they're getting a pretty bad deal.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
There's also kind of opportunity moment for renewal,
mm-hmm.
in that there's a lot of desire to see change in the organisation in lots of different ways, and changing the kind of outward public face of that is very important, I think, in terms of perception.
Yeah,
I was saying the mission statement can be redefined, or at least defined in some way, and it can be presented to the world.
Well, almost in doing the website, you bring all of those questions out that all of these all of these meetings are to do, to try and redefine what we want it to be, and I think that all of those need to, if the website was what they were feeding into, then you know, that would be a great way forward.
Mm.
Get on it, Christina.
I'm hesitant to bring this up or not, but obviously there's another strand of communication, which is the quarterly that goes out. Just out of curiosity, for the purpose of covering, you know, some of the things that were raised in the November workshop a little bit, if the website was a good enough platform where you maybe actually did go on to see what was happening in architecture, what practices were doing what, does that kind of render the quarterly?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, there's someone contributes to that, someone puts it together, it's someone's role, it's someone's job.
Is it
but
paper or is it?
It's paper.
But it may be that that news goes online and that money gets reinvested, you know,
and to upkeep of what of the website.
Well, you have to be a wee bit careful about that. You have to be a wee bit careful because the purpose of the, I used to be the convener of the committee that produced the Prospect magazine, which you're all too young to remember.
Mm. I remember. It was better.
It was way better.
Yeah, well, Stuart Campbell. And there was a group of us who did it, and it was a lot of work. It was a resurrection of a magazine that had been in the RIS many, many years before, and then somehow they lost it. But the idea of the quarterly was that you had something that promoted architecture that would appear on somebody's coffee table or on the table of an office or something where somebody's waiting, and they would pick it up and look at it and be interested. The website would do that, but not quite in the same way. So if the magazine was maybe better,
the Welsh Architects Institute actually produces a really good magazine.
Yeah,
I don't think it's quarterly, I think it's annual.
Well, but maybe it could be that, but
it's beautifully done.
You know, it's not. Because the website's great, but it's not on everyone's.
Yeah, I agree with that. Like, I wouldn't necessarily.
You certainly don't want to see any pictures of golfing outings.
No. Or where I went on my holiday.
Oh, yeah.
I don't
It's interesting.
We're a small industry. There's not a lot of us, actually. Mm. You know, there's fewer architects in Scotland than there are even in London.
But there's so much treasure.
Yeah, not making any comment about quality of Scotland. But maybe we need to do less, but do it better.
Mm.
Just actually kind of focus on fewer things, but invest more in them.
There's actually been a real like resurgence of niche print publishing.
Yeah.
You probably
yeah.
all know this just from going into independent bookshops and things.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, I think if you think about it, it's not just you lot that are interested in an architecture, nerdy architecture magazine. Other people will be as well.
Blueprint was always a good example.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, for designers,
Monocle's a bit of a gentleman's thing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That's how I feel about it.
Fashion
and food. We need to start
Monocle. It might be in the name. Don't see many women wearing monocles.
Well, not many men wearing monocles.
I think Helen's just hit, has you know landed on the subject that it's. I don't have the data for it. Like I'm not sure about the data for that, but the amount of you know gender balance in architecture schools.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know gender balance in practices, but in which you know age group. So there's no problem with the gender balance in the schools, but then if you open the magazine. Is that always the same thing? So yeah, I think it's very interesting to come up with the idea of annual magazine, but it's tied into a refreshed and utterly regrown website that comes out of probably what a new chapter is doing.
And they relate to each other.
Yeah.
But you know, a lot of probably most practices that are represented here have probably got really quite good, interesting websites and produce interesting material.
Mm-hmm.
So there's already stuff that's there.
Yeah.
But there's already, you know, you're already communicating that on your own, you know, so.
But you know, there might still
collected.
Be the directory, because it's also the data show that most practices, 80% of practices have fewer than 5 employees or something like that.
Yeah.
So we always read about the ones that are 30 to 40 strong,
yeah.
But actually that's not representative.
Yeah.
But there's, what I was meaning was there's a lot of material
dynamic material that's being generated already when you're, you know, when a building is finished and you're commissioning photography, and there's lots of interesting stories already there. It just that you're all producing it in your little silos.
Yeah, imagine,
you know,
if there was an annual Dropbox. Put your three best images in, and then
imagine going through it.
but it's that kind
of idea, like just looking at what everybody's doing together rather than off. You know, you've all got to have your own little, you know, your own little domains, but it could all be collected together because it does already exist. If you wanted to.
The source material's there.
Yeah, and like I thought that was quite interesting hearing about what you were saying about how this is like this. That it was like we need to do something and we're going to do it.
It's just
and
history.
That's fine. That's
history.
Do you know what? That's often like
Lots of times
that happens to everybody.
Time, we'll come back later on.
Yeah.
But it really is a shame because you then invest so much energy
in
getting it going and doing
something.
It that it's very hard to then come back from.
Absolutely.
As you can.
When to introduce you, Andy, and we got totally distracted. But it's quite good because it's a big tie-in with regards to the public interface and platform for architecture. So Andy is an architect, but also the co-founder and co-producer of the Architecture Fringe, which we've probably all been to, participated in. Also design tutor at the University of Edinburgh and photographer. And he's previously worked at Zaha Hadid Architects and Oliver Chapman. And in my opinion, again, and maybe I'm being, and maybe it's just me, but I feel like it's really kind of leading the way, essentially, especially with the Architecture Fringe in Scotland, with how architecture connects with the public. It's definitely a new and exciting interface.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, Kristen.
Take the floor.
Okay. Good evening. How are you doing? So the workshop back in November, I read through what people had talked about, the communication thread, and thanks. And how I had read it was that people were actually obviously very interested in how things looked, but from that workshop I think there was much more discussion about the actual structures that will then produce something which looks better. And I had also gone through the website and screen grabbed loads of stuff for my own Retina archive, and also had a big problem with communication regards to the RS on Twitter, for example. The Twitter handle was someone's face for a long time, and well, member of staff. So the sort of external communication of the IRS was very poor.
Was it?
Yeah, for me. It was very poor.
Just can't resist saying that. Yeah.
But I think we've got covered most of that, touched on that today anyway. So I wanted to try and just sort of look at a bigger picture, shall we say, about it, in terms of what is the whole point of going through all this? Because what is the point if we don't have a sort of idea of what we want to do in Scotland here as a profession? So I've got a provocation for you later on in this presentation, which is a provocation. It's just for some chat. So it'll be nice to hear what people's thoughts are, if it's achievable or whatever, because we're all here together. So I wrote a post on Basecamp, which is the new chapter discussion group, back in I think it was in February, saying, you know, out there beyond the RIS, to try and basically get a bit of a wider look beyond sort of micro topics to sort of give us an overall sort of direction of what we wanted to do. But before I go through that, I'll just sort of touch on a bit about me. So I am from Edinburgh. I went to Edinburgh College of Art. I'm an architect. I was a member of the RIS for 14 years and I left this year, out of disgust. Anyway, but I paid my dues. Yes, I trained at ECA, went to Copenhagen on Erasmus, and then finished at the Bartlett in London. I worked in Zaha's for quite a long time. I was in the Riverside Museum on site for 2.5 years. I also teach at the university with Julie, my teaching partner here. And I live and work in Glasgow. I'm also a photographer, as Christine mentioned. So my full name is Andrew Rob McRae Summers. So for architecture, I'm Andy Summers, and for photography, I'm Rob McRae in the middle, because it's just liberating to sort of keep the discipline separate. So if I do a really shit building, it doesn't fit my
photos. But I do a lot of portrait work actually, but also a lot of my work is about perception in the built environment. This is some large format work in London looking at parting walls. It's niche, I'm an architect, you know. But it's about residual traces in the cityscape, which are often go unnoticed. And being from Edinburgh, I mean, Edinburgh is a very difficult place aesthetically, I think, to be contemporary here. So I'm from the western suburbs. So I've been documenting the architectures of the western suburbs to try to expand the visual representation of the city. It's all really from Calton Hill, which is Edinburgh represented internationally. It's all stone, but a more plural aesthetic for the city and almost more contemporary one is to actually look around us a little bit more. So that's been an interesting one for me to sort of go back through where I grew up and sort of see things afresh. I'm also an event producer, so this is sort of some of the work I've done in the past, which has a point we've seen in a second. Is I came back to Scotland for the referendum in 2013, and the arts group National Collective, we did a month-long 28-day tour of Scotland, just looking at the referendum as a topic for the arts. And as the main logistics person for that tour, we almost died. It looked good, but it was really tough going. Then helped run an event. I mean, I've done loads of stuff over with it, but this was an event looking at culture in Scotland. After the referendum, it's as a group of people what we wanted to do. And then sort of politically again, Change in Scotland. I ran the last one with Jerry Hassan and Mary McFadgen. Again, looking at politics, culture and ideas in Scotland. So I'm always sort of being plural in discussions, not just sort of siloed in our own bits and bobs. That's all of my website for architecture. I mean, some of my photography one is completely separate. But again, just event production, talks, things like that. And all that sort of then led to the Architecture Fringe. So in National Collective, there was two architects, like a zoo, or like the Ark. There was two poets, two architects, two of everybody else, and we sort of came out and were, I mean, I think the whole of Scotland was a little bit more, it was tiring, the referendum, but people got used to talking about society and sort of just talking about stuff that affected us. And architecture obviously affects us in a huge way. So we wanted to try and keep that momentum going with regards to public buildings and what architecture did in society and things like that. And the Year of Innovation Architecture Design was coming up, obviously, back in, this is 2015, back in 2016. And the Year of Innovation Architecture Design obviously had a Festival of Architecture, and we didn't really understand or know how to partake in that as individual people. It seemed very top-heavy and very top-led, and didn't sort of have perhaps the energy about it, but that was all what we thought back of house. So we basically decided to start a fringe on our own. We didn't ask. We just decided to do it ourselves. Scotland is a small place, and for professional courtesy, we did speak to the IRS, Karen Cunningham. We took her through our plans with the fringe would be. The IRS and Neil were the first people we followed on Twitter, for example. We weren't hiding. But the fringe has never said anything publicly about the Festival of Architecture. We just went and did something else. And we're still going. So the first one was in July 2016. And why we basically do an architecture fringe is to support new work and emerging practice in architecture in Scotland. We're trying to develop a friendly but critical community of voices, plural, to connect, support and challenge each other to try and keep up standards, quality and not sort of get into a small Scotland state of not seeing anything because, you know, it's fine. We try and offer a platform to encourage a wider conversation about architecture and design in Scotland, critically also design. In our contemporary culture and socio-political context, because that really is what we practice in. And to engage internationally with other people and organisations, which is crucial for us. We've just been in Kiev 2 weeks ago for the Cannes Actions International Architecture Festival. We presented the Fringe, how we work and how it's structured, and also took through a more sort of broader sort of sample of what's going on in Scotland for contemporary activities. We have Voices of Experience, which is a project based in Glasgow about women in architecture, with Test Unit, which is a summer school, and we had Crumble magazine, which is from Edinburgh University. Actually, let me rephrase that. It's from students who went to Edinburgh University. It's got nothing to do with Edinburgh University. So this is just what some people have said about us. I'm not saying that's true, but it's just to take you through what the feedback we get. The feedback's very important for us. We do a huge amount of feedback during the festival and after for our audience and for contributors, because it's extremely important to understand how people are founding the Fringe. So we did start in 2016. This is the colours we've gone through. Every year we change colour. I don't use a Mac, but I actually only noticed this like a month ago that that's the same colours as the top of the Mac. But basically what the logo is about is this is the centre and this is the Fringe. So that's kind of basically what we've been investigating. We change colour every year just to keep it fresh and it's fun. So we're on green for 2018. And we, likewise, which I wanted to say about the magazine we're just talking about, actually, I think producing physical things is extremely important for your own archive, but also for audiences to touch something and engage with what you're doing in a different way, which is offline. And we're very interested in our own archive, and we take a lot of time producing the work that we do for print. And with Neil McGuire, who's our designer, he's one of the co-producers, we produce a lot of printed material for the festival every year. This was from 2017. And so we try to have a provocation, basically, for the Fringe in terms of just to sort of put some ideas out there. And the core programme basically reflects that provocation, but the open programme does not have to respond to that. Last year, we looked at the infrastructure of architecture in Scotland with an eye of what was beginning to happen with the RAS, but also how unhappy people were with publishing, with procurement, with how architects were perceived, how client relationships. So we developed three main strands for the festival last year, which is public life, perception and practice. And then structured within that, we have some research, which is very important for us, an output, obviously, and then a debate to talk about that output. So just one of those strands, for example, was the public life strand. So we had a little guerrilla pop-up research office in Edinburgh City Council in the planning department. They were very helpful for us. We're just basically analysing the system of what planning was, and then to question that. And obviously it's all really about economic development, which even people even you still don't understand. We all blame the planners. It's got nothing really to do with the planners. It's all about the economic development department. So we were trying to sort of share that wider knowledge with the public. New typologies was looking at new ways of public buildings. So what will our community centres look like in the future? What about our health centres, public toilets? And I'll come on to that in a second. We had some lovely models and some drawings. And then we had piss poor planning, was a debate, to again try and draw attention to that actually there's no point in being annoyed at the planners per se. It's really the economic development department we all have to be annoyed at. So crucial to the Architecture Fringe is the Open Programme. The Open Programme is free to take part in. We do not curate access to that. We do try and keep an eye on quality, but generally people do what they like for the Fringe. Current conversations at Create Scotland, for example, the Scottish Government's policy and culture, they're trying to define culture. I would say you can't define culture, and you shouldn't, in terms of the Orange Order, for example, is a culture in Scotland. It's none of my business that once you say they are not a culture. So when you define culture, i.e. when you curate something, you are then kind of stamping or not enabling things to come up. So we do not curate content for the Architecture Fringe of the programme. It's crucial because that's where new cultures come from. We just try and keep an eye on quality. And we have very strict submission guidance, and we run monthly meetups every month to try and, you know, instill a bit of chat, and it's like a crit, and it's also a great way for people to meet each other. We flip-flop between Edinburgh and Glasgow, but beyond that, it's really up to you what you do in the open programme. It's none of our business. Mission is sort of architecture and UKIP. This was a new typologies project I mentioned before, so this is Dress for the Weather. This is Adam Nathaniel Furman, this is McGinley Bell. So they were looking at this is a community centre, it's a town hall, and this is a health centre. So new typology was just looking at what are these buildings going to look like in 25 years' time. That's the limit we set. So Dress for the Weather, very interesting, sort of open access. There was no front door to the community centre. It was all filigree, you just wander in, there's big public rooms, a big lovely model. Adam's sort of new democratic movement was the town hall, as a sort of celebration of many things. I and McGinley Bell were on a health centre, and this was about holisticism, in terms of like this sort of holistic opening for our minds and our hearts to come into a building which was, again, very open and free. So they really took the briefs very seriously, and I'd say we had some beautiful models from these. This year we're doing a new project So it's springing from this called Frankentypes, which is marrying two use classes or typologies which might not be go together in our minds, but will be a new building type. So it might be a BMX track with a sexual health centre, for example, because they're all young people, things like that. Chris is leading on this, so if you don't like it, blame him. This was our team from last year, our closing lecture at the National Museum, which is part of our core programme. We had Kath Slesser, who's the ex-editor of the AR, Beatrice Galley, who's Assistant Curator of Architecture at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and Sam Jacob from FACT historically, but also now Sam Jacob Studio. And they were basically a creator, curator and a critic, going through the infrastructure of architecture in a sort of more world terms. This was our production team from last year. This is our production team from this year. So we're generally doing the same. We have some new friends and new voices with us. And we're not all architects, which is unbelievably crucial. We have facilitators, we have landscape architects, we have designers, we have an engineer, we have some students, and we have a curator. So it's a broad group of people, which is the whole point. And together we produce the core program and run the open platform. And in general, it's been good people for 3 years. Again, just touching on what other people say about the Fringe, Jude, obviously Barbara, as I'm sure of you know, just reflecting that it provides a space and time to reflect, challenge and imagine, which can go back to our sort of core objectives. This was actually written on our backboard last summer at Civic House. It's a really lovely thing to hear, because obviously teaching, and we've all been there as well. It's really great to see that the Fringe is making a difference to some younger people who might go but come back, who knows. And then the combination of meaningful critique and balanced energy, it's tiring though, is infectious and welcome. And we just try and keep things light, but are incredibly serious about what we do. And a force for good. We didn't paste them, so say that, that's what it said. This year the provocation is Common Senses. That's a bit right. We did go into the Architecture Fringe website. We don't want to do that. There is some white not reading. But Common Senses this year is that's a provocation, and we'll be exploring that for the core programme. So basically, common is what are we doing collectively as society. It can also be about vulgarity. There's loads of different dictionary definitions of common. And then the senses aspect of that is a more ephemeral things, space and touch and feel. So marrying these things is what we're kind of exploring through the core programme this year. We've got very good support from Helen. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So how the Architecture Fringe works, there's kind of three tenets to which I've touched on already. We have the Architecture Fringe is an organisation, which is us group where I showed you earlier. We're a non-profit community interest company, and we worked unbelievably hard over 3 years to build structure into the Architecture Fringe behind us. We're all volunteers, there's no staff. We all have full-time jobs. So obviously it takes a lot of work, but basically the sort of three things that make the Fringe up is the organisation, the core programme, but crucially the open programme. So all these things coalesce to make the Architecture Fringe what it is. We have plans of what we want the Fringe to try and become, but we will get there working on things, but it's a mutation. Crucially, as always, we have never seen ourselves as a silo. We are in a mosaic of architectural culture in Scotland, the three things here. And as I say, from the very start, we have kept people informed and up to date. And that mosaic of architectural culture in Scotland is kind of crucial and should be growing and should be plural. But every single thing is kind of important, including obviously a professional body, shall I say. Maybe not this one. I don't know, just saying. But, institutes, Lighthouse is important, for example, academia is important, media publishing, all these things are crucial and critical, and we should be trying to nourish and self-support each thing, but still remain critical. That's the whole point. It's not a cozy members club. If things are not good, we have to say. So, this is my provocation. Throw stuff at me. Basically, what I was thinking about following things with Basecamp and obviously following things with IRS and things like that, it's all very good, it's great, it's activity, but what's the whole point of all this? Where are we going? What do we want to do? Are we really going to be talking about procurement in 10 years' time? I hope not, because I really can't be bothered. So all this sort of energy and new ideas and new reflections and sort of the growing plurality of architectural culture in Scotland, where can we direct this perhaps? This is just sort of touching on some of the organisations and bodies that exist in architecture here. And it's just about architecture, not about some other built environment organisations. I've left them out because they're not architects. This is just about architects for me at the moment, anyway. BEFS, for example, an amazing organisation, but obviously about built environment from Scotland, but they're not architects, they're not on the slide. And crucially, I have put in the chapters for the IRS. It's a federal structure, apparently, they should perhaps be supported or have more autonomy. I have no idea, it's up for discussion, but how do we engender people to basically just run and get on things and not be sort of constricted through some centrifugal force? ANDS I've put on up there, you know, because they're actually quasi-governmental, but you know, they do play an important role in obviously the schools of architecture, the Lighthouse as a venue, a new chapter which we are all going to be aware of, the Architectural Historical Society of Scotland, the Landscape Institute I've included because they're architects, publishing, that's kind of all we've got, apart from their magazine, and culturally, and the Architecture Fringe obviously. So this mosaic of architectural culture, I'm proposing that we try and form an alliance for architecture to basically try and streamline a lot of overlapping activity, to lobby the government basically, to try and get some things actually sorted out, because really, stop talking about the same shit in 10 years' time.
Absolutely.
I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to emigrate. I'm honestly not interested in doing it. How do we stop? How do we not get there? So where we're at, I think, basically, is what do we need to do? And so overall, where we're at for the profession, I think, as we're going through things like this, is to recognise and accept that change needs to happen. So I think it's been very encouraging. A new chapter and what's sort of formulating of the RAS at Rutland Square, it needs to change. But that's also a lot of other things. To be self-critical and honest with ourselves, acknowledge what is wrong and why. So again, this goes back to Scotland being Scotland. You know, sometimes I don't think we say things because it's too small, it's too impolite. I don't think we can say things constructively, because if we don't learn, we're just going to make the same mistakes. To look around us and aim high, so that's maybe looking a bit wider, beyond just our geographical location, looking at people who do things well. So what's been nice in the new chapter, there's been a lot of posts with regards to some architectural institutes in Denmark and things, and how they are run and things like that, and that's what we kind of need to do, it's very interesting. And initiate an accumulative transformative momentum for change. This is kind of hard, but it's kind of crucial. And I think we're all very busy, but I think that's the main thing to try and keep going with regards to taking advantage of what has actually happened in architecture since last summer, which is quite a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So why an alliance? Well, it's to build relationships and support on common issues, issue by issue. So that's extremely important, which I'll come on to the next slide. But as I say, there's a lot of people doing similar things, and that's great. But what actually happens, and where does it go? What happens to the information? Does it even get to the government to change anything? I have no idea. I don't think so. So to align and pool isolated work to avoid repetitive actions, to take advantage of an opportunity, which I think has really arrived, and to stop talking about that. How might an alliance work? So in my back of my mind, I've got this little voice who's not going to work. I don't know. I think it could. But how it works is kind of crucial to get it right to make it work. So I think basically you have to be nimble. And we, the profession, and all those different myriad of organisations and places, like we're doing now, should try and identify and agree common ground. What is the main issues for architects and architecture in Scotland? Who can come together on certain things, and where do we want things to go, and how do we want it to change? And work on an issue-by-issue basis. So, obviously organisations, they run themselves, they've all got their own regulations, charities, whatever, you know, everyone's really busy. If you make something too tight, it's not going to work. So issue-by-issue just keeps it nimble, keeps it safe, in terms of people coming in, access to things. So people can come and go. If there's an alliance of all those things, people don't have to be on board for every single issue. That's not actually going to happen. And for some people, some issues actually aren't so important. Like procurement's not an important issue for the SALA in the university, maybe for the States Department, but not for teaching necessarily. So they might not be on board for that. But so it just keeps it loose and keeps it nimble. But to strike a balance between structure and autonomy, which is what I was trying to say about the Architecture Fringe earlier, in terms of we do not curate what we do, we just provide a structure and a support. So the alliance would be structured in a way where, as I say, the organisations look after themselves, but for issue by issue, they come together and we try and sort some stuff out because it keeps things loose. And encourage and support a plural, diverse mosaic of participants. That means that in organisations, but also in people terms, fund. Things actually have to be funded, I would suggest. We are all volunteers for the Architecture Fringe. It's unbelievably difficult. Obviously, people who take part at the Rutland Square are not paid in general. But for this to work, you know, we've got a £19 billion industry in the United Kingdom. I'm sure we could try and get some money to create this thing to happen. And importantly, how might an alliance not work? So, reflecting on what we touched on earlier, for other organisations, unclear structure, objections and vision. Obviously, we need to communicate what on earth it is we're trying to do, but if it's issue by issue, it's much easier to be focused on, say, procurement, whatever. Micromanagement of organisations, so that's, again, it's not going to work. We're not going to be running from Rutland Square. So just keep it loose, and as I say, issue by issue, you'll come in when you want. A lack of consistent mental activity, this is about being busy and actually doing stuff. You know, talk is good, but things have to be done. And I think it's great these days the workshops have been happening because that's new. And a lot of issues are being talked about which haven't been talked about before at Rutland Square. And we touched on before about, you know, how do we know about diversity in the profession, how do we know about LGBT issues, racism. We have no idea in Scotland really unless you partake in the AJ survey down in London. I don't think the IRAS asks these questions. I'm not sure, I could be wrong, I apologise if I am, but I don't have a clue about the professions.
That's one of the key outcomes over the last one of these discussions, really, is that data needs to be gathered.
Yeah, and it's not hard.
Yeah, exactly.
Not hard. A lack of transparency and accountability, we've all gone watched things like that down there, but that's unbelievably critically important for trust. In the 21st century, there's no need for an organisation like this to be not like that. And poor communication, presentation, and content based on quality. That would be how an alliance would not work. So the overall objectives, what's the whole point? It's trying to transform architecture in Scotland, basically. You know, it's not that bad, but it could be better. As I say, you know, we teach in the first year. Acutely aware that we're just churning out students into the same system that we're all experiencing, which isn't perfect, and basically doesn't produce good work. Why are we doing that? No idea. To realign architectural education, so that's crucial, that's where we all start. I know SALA tried very hard to engage with practice, and obviously that's a much bigger issue at UK level for RBA and ARB and all that stuff, you know, but do we have a view in it? I would hope so. So what do you want to do about it? Reset procurement. I know, for example, Malcolm Fraser, a lot of people are working hard on this.
Mm.
It's very crucial. I think there might be movement soon in the Scottish Government for that, which is great. But how do we ensure there's a backup for those people who are doing that to make sure it actually happens? Pluralise, and diversify. Need some wine. In all areas.
Pulverise is the mixing of those two.
Good point. And nourish the discipline, both within us and between us, and this is very crucial. In our unit, we get our students to go to the library, and they have to bring in books, because they can't read DC in art theory every time, they have to actually read a book. And it's about nourishing why we are all interested and love architecture. You know, in the construction industry, the QS doesn't really like. You know, structural engineers are our closest ally in terms of creativity, we all know that. But beyond that, in the construction profession, there's no one else like us. And we are still interested in discipline, surely, for the rest of our lives, because that's why we're here. So that is crucial with regards to what this is all about. And when I say nourish, I mean, you know, stuff in the Architecture Fringe, or this event, or reading, or going visiting a building, all these things that kind of make it have a point. What is the point in sort of procurement if we don't love good buildings? So that's important. So that might be events or whatever, but that means also sort of the soft power angle for Architecture Scotland. I think the Architecture Fringe plays a crucial role in that for architectural culture. So yes, within us and between us, like being here today. And fundamentally, that was what I started with, and it's just to basically have a bigger picture. That's it.
Does anyone have any questions?
That's not my
right away.
Wait.
There we are, glorious triangle.
Yeah. So I don't know if anyone's got any like thoughts about analyze. Does that sound
okay?
Crap?
Yes. Good, good. I'll let you out and lock the door behind you.
Forum Scotland. It's about providing this forum for people to hear each other. And I just don't feel that we as a profession or our professional body do enough of that. I'm not sure that all of it's heading in the right direction, but I think an alliance starts to happen.
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously the built environment cross-party group at Holyrood as well. And I think the problem for us is that as a sort of, if there's an architect at the table, say our architecture at the table, I have no idea what we're saying. I don't think we even know, you know. And the cross-party group, I think, was almost disbanded. It's keeping going, but I don't think it's professionally utilised that leverage properly there. And that then reflects back right back into Holyrood to say that the architects kind of wishy-washy, they don't know what they're doing. They're not important, basically. And BEFS, I think, is a great thing because they can't take a stand on stuff. BEFS, they're at the forum. But what are the architects saying in that forum? Or what's architecture saying in that forum? I don't know. You know, I think the heritage sector is a bit more better organised, perhaps. But that slide I showed about not including BEFS, for example, or Coburn, for example, is because they're not architects. You know, so just as what are we wanting to say? Let's not, we're not going to agree, but we have to say something. And I think too often we say nothing. Sure,
there's
but how you do that is...
Yeah, that's what I mean. There's a lot of apathy there. But at the same time, you know, there are lots of people who work very hard as volunteers as well. So I know what you'd say about funding, but actually, as a group of people, architects are rather conscientious, I would say, you know, generally speaking. And if there was a clear voice and clear goal and vision, I'm sure that we'll get there and do something about it. But at the moment, the structure, the vision, and everything is unclear and obscure and non-transparent. So nobody's knowing what we're striving for, so everybody just goes, oh, well, I'm just, you know.
So the REN specifically, or Architecture Scotland? Because they're different.
Well, mostly RIS, but I think there is also a non-transparency between organisations as well. So as you say, they work in silos, and you know, what BEFS is doing, they're doing that, AHS doing that, and, you know, and there isn't a lot of common ground that's built up yet, but that you're trying to say that the alliance should build together. And I think if there's a common ground of that vision, and people understand that better, then, you know, there will be an impetus to engage more. Because there is no understanding, then what worry, what are we engaging with? Nobody knows, so everybody just sits back.
I think the difficulty is that the RIAS, as it stands, have the ears of the architecture community, and it's how you try to get the ears listening to other you know, songs, that, you know, that there's something else out there. There's so, you know, because it's been that way for so long that the RAS have the directory of people, you know, so I think that's a problem for a new chapter, kind of getting their voice beyond base camp, beyond, and presumably for the architecture fringe as well. It's how do we take the next steps? How do we get there? And I guess that's the question fundamentally asking as well. It's like, we're sick of talking about this, everybody knows the issues, let's deal with them, but it's like how. You almost need the RAS to kind of be the horse that takes you to the people, and then you leave it behind.
I think there's a real sort of strength in the organisation in all of that stuff.
Yeah.
It does actually have some potential representation to government. You know, it's very telling that on the RFA website today, it has their statement on the Hackett report.
Yeah.
You know, what is RAS's statement on that, for example? We don't necessarily know.
Yeah.
That there are discussions going on along those topics, you know, in RAS, but it needs to get better at performing that role, kind of talking for the industry and also the industry thing like that. It's a voice that's being projected back, because it's not. It's
yeah,
not
it,
that
it's
well.
Not a different issue, because, you know, it's the question, I guess, you're putting out there from throwing stones at is the RAS relevant? You know, is it, you know, is, do we want to say anything? Maybe, you know, there's a group of people who are all, you know, an agreed vision. So if everybody from all of the parties agreed that join the alliance, come together, they meet once a month and they have a joint statement that goes out there, you know, so the RAS might still have its view, but might not.
It was, I mean, my sort of thought on it was that you need a professional body.
Yeah.
That's a given, right?
Mm-hmm.
You do need one. And that professional body has to be the primary engager with the government for lobbying and discussion. It's not the architecture fringe, it's not the EAA, and these are a bigger thing, right? And okay, the royal and the name, people don't like, whatever. But the RAS does have capacity within it. And I'm not even saying I'm going to rejoin it, but it's got value. Because as you were saying earlier, when things have heritage or past, and it is a known thing, it's not just, you can't throw it all away. So it's trying to take on the best aspects for it, because that is the best vehicle to be the centre of this alliance.
And that's what I mean, right? It has the ears of the whole profession.
Yeah, I mean,
it needs
there's
to be.
Nothing wrong with the umbrella, it's all the spokes that are fairly toxic.
Yeah.
Can I say
to
something
put it
a bit controversial? I'm not an architect, and I don't know what all these initials mean.
Yeah, I know what
you're
going to say.
And I'm sitting here and I'm thinking about the. The Monty Python film.
I just
realised. The People's Front of Judea. And I'm kind of sitting here thinking, well, does it really matter? Yes, it probably doesn't matter what you're called, but you have to be called something. And then I thought, well, what is it you want? And you've actually just said, I was in my head, I was thinking, well, you just be called anything. You know, but, I mean, you couldn't, it's important, but you've called something. And then I thought, well, what is it you want? And you just said it, you know, you need representation in government, and, you know, the rules are much better than I do, because you know what you want. But, you know, it feels like it could be simplified quite a lot.
SAS, that's what we need. Scottish Architects Society.
But Andy,
I mean,
it has
to have an SAS function.
Yeah.
It's such a brilliant talk, and I've learned so much, and I know, and I think it's, but it's, I've learned more about the architecture fringe than I ever knew, and about this, you know, the alliance. But everybody can see it's a real soapbox moment, because there's a gap in the leadership right now. So it's almost as if everybody's actually pitching for that. But you know, you're on the third year of this, and it must be exhausting. But I think the reason why we don't have any one representation is, like what Gloria said, conscientious person. So we are heavily tasked on all fronts just to survive. But so when you give your time to a voluntary thing, it's because you're desperate to do it. You have to do it, so you'll do it for nothing. And then after a certain time, you can have a type of burnout, and it depends whether you replenish that or not. So you've been achieving a huge amount, and you have people's ear now, I think, as well, which is a good thing. But there must be so many PhDs written on, you know, internal structure of organisations. And I actually spend my life currently going and giving time for voluntary community projects. And that's why I just recently looked at I want to see that clip for the popular front of People's
Yeah, no, that's what's going to be the People's
Judea.
People's Front of Judea.
Exactly, they're all so similar. But I mean, I'm familiar with all the acronyms here. But so, yeah, there's clearly, but then when you compare us thinking, you know, there needs to be, there are roles, of, and I'm not an expert in RAAS governance, but I know a couple of people who are, and they'll be either in the room or plenty, you know, a few who are not here. So I think that they're probably already thoughts about which role splits into two and what is the next title. But a paid role is really essential to keep this going, to keep that going. I mean, I remember within the last few months, head of place was tendered at the council. I clicked on that, wow, it's between 90 and 100 grand to be head of place. And let's read what the job, okay, it's too boring before you get, you know, 75% of the way down. But you know, there is real money being put into things, and then they do some, you know, streetscape things and say, we're going to do this with RMBA tendering process. But there isn't actually an architect involved. So, you know, there is surely funding available for those roles that can move this forward. You probably know much more about it than I do. But it's
well,
like there's
an architect gets involved, they stop paying. Malcolm did that whole town centre of Newcastle, didn't get a single penny for it. Not a penny. Such an important piece of work, and it's so, you know, it's absolutely disgusting. He was told he might get some honorary payment at the end. He never paid him a penny. You know, and it was months and months and months of work and travelling the length and breadth of the country, and you just think that's how much value they actually put on it. So, you know, the minute you get someone who cares, like architects do, they think they don't need to pay them. So that's head of place, if an architect had been employed, they'd probably have a quarter of the salary.
I think that's something that needs to be examined.
Yeah.
That needs to be examined, because even in the arts, like the amount of events that we run, we pay everybody but ourselves. Because you have to pay people where you can. And architects...
But you're respecting the work they're doing.
Yes, of course. That's what the point is. I think architects need to be less altruistic and not do stuff for free. Because we do, that's my point. I'm saying we love what we do. This is the problem. You get taken advantage of.
Yes.
And the whole thing needs to toughen up. You know, and say, because there's no way you get a lawyer or anybody else to have one. It's going to be serious.
Because we're so passionate.
A plumber.
Do we then become too passionate and actually have too little self-respect, therefore, you know. We respect others, so we pay them to do their work. So does that mean that we do not respect ourselves?
I'm not sure that it's not lack of self-respect, but it's such a strong desire for something to happen that you're actually prepared to throw everything at it, which is what happens. You know, you just want something to happen, so you throw everything at it. You're prepared to throw time at things that you're passionate about.
It all goes back to the root topic as well, where if your platform's right, if your vision is right, if everyone, you know, if there is an alliance, if people are coordinated, then there's a system, there's a methodology to that, and it becomes clear, and people aren't kind of scrambling to do things or searching for people to do things. It the communication aspect, the alliance aspect's almost, it adds uniformity to that, which helps make a platform as well to build off, essentially. And I think there's two really interesting things that have come up in that, talking about the alliance as a form of communication and a form of strength, is like my personal take on it, essentially. The RIS in that is that it does have the connections, and it's whether it doesn't have to be centrifugal, although I quite like that kind of mental picture of that happening. But it's an impressive structure as a body. It's got weight, and I think something that's come out of this is there's obviously so much happening, there's so much energy. Doesn't harness it.
I think that, I mean, it's only through the new chapter that I've started to understand the structure. You know, like Julie said, the EAA is a whole lot older than the RIAS, you know, and it's... you know, and it's an independent body, it's, you know, and you just don't know that about the chapters, that they are actually, they do what they like. Look at Julie, she's doing what she wants to do. She's decided we're going to get a grip of this, despite the RIAS. I would say. Would you agree with that,
Julie? I'm on film.
I mean, communication-wise, though, would anyone object if,
you know, the RIS, you know, I don't know whether you'd want it to be endorsed, but let's just say the RIS promoted the fringe. They weren't involved.
Did they do this year? Because it's not, I mean, it's about quality, right? And as I say, the very start in 2015, Akiko and I went to see Karen Cunningham because she was a festival director, right? So back of house, so front of house we said nothing. But back of house, Scotland's smaller professionals, so we went to speak to them. And it's not about not talking to the IRS or doing something different, it's about quality.
Yeah.
They weren't good enough, fundamentally. And obviously someone was there leading an organisation who we refused to talk to, because we're not stupid. We spoke to Karen, and we keep in touch very close with Karen Stevenson, because she took on the festival, now she's obviously in the higher role. We know her very well. And so it's fine, and they promote us, and they know us hands off. They're actually kind of getting it.
Yeah.
But I think, like, to reinforce the IRS, it's maybe just an idea of how it might be done, because how can the Architecture Fringe talk to the Dundee chapter? Okay, you can email them, phone, but you know what I mean? How can we actually talk to them on a level where everyone else is there and have some just dialogue between all the different factors?
Yeah.
How can the schools of architecture actually, you know, so just having a sort of a round form of an alliance, shall we say, like BEST, I guess, in reality, but just then where issues can be discussed and maybe some, I mean, there could be three people run a procurement workshop next month. What's the point?
Yeah.
Just do it together. And then we focus and send stuff to the governor, you know, but just try to do something like that.
So it's connectivity as well as communication, essentially, and they're the,
yeah,
the, kind of, the nucleus
for
that, essentially.
Or the centre of it, because I say you need a professional body, you know, and I don't think we can start a new one. I just don't think it's going
to
happen.
I don't think we need to. I just think we need a clear out.
Yeah.
We need a clear out and possibly a slightly different name.
Possibly.
Just saying.
Maybe it's the message.
But then there's a whole kind of legal status around it. It's kind of roiling incorporationalness.
But maybe
I didn't appreciate either. But that's a thing.
Yeah, but that doesn't matter. I mean, constitutions and whatnot can change.
Yeah. I mean, it can have a constituted name and use a different name, just like we all can, like Andy does.
No,
I'm
going to
do that. That's a really good idea.
Well, on a serious point, I'm not sure many people know that the IRAS can't represent themselves internationally.
Mm-hmm.
Because
no,
of the agreement with the RIBA.
Yeah.
Right? So we can sit and moan about Scottish architecture not being put wherever in Europe, but the IRAS is not allowed to represent itself internationally because of the agreement with the RIBA. So if we're not happy about that as a group of people, then we either change our IRS or we have to then change something else. But I think, who even knows that? This is a problem.
Yeah.
I think, obviously, things around the square are being difficult based on people, but fundamentally, the structural issues there, that the people around the square need to help with, you know?
So, you know, there could be another chapter that could engage internationally, the international chapter.
Yeah,
I
just think they should just do it, not ask. But then
Well, there are actually six chapters, and then there's also another class of membership called
Edwith. I love that one. That is a very Scottish
members of the RAS who don't live in Scotland.
Oh.
So there is a more international.
No, we want to talk to
membership.
The Scandinavians and all those interesting people. We had some Helsinki architects in here last week, and you know, we thought, oh, it'd be just so great to work with them on something, or you know, keep that relationship going.
Well, in education, they keep having these.
Yeah.
Oh, let's have a study visit to Finland. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there have been, you know, schools, there's children in Scotland.
Well, Peter Wilson does a lot of, you know, engaging with.
But the architecture, the government architectural wing does it as well out in Iceland, Denmark, you know, is happening. But again, how that connects back into the profession in a meaningful way.
Mm. That's happening in Scotland with craft. Actually, Craft Scotland does exchanges.
Yeah.
They've just done one with Iceland, and they send a group of designers to go and work there with a group of Icelandic designers. I think they've maybe done it in other countries as well. So it's already happening on the quasi-governmental level.
I mean,
Archie
Fringe are doing it.
We're that's part of our remit. We don't have any money. Not saying it's a point.
Craft Scotland is a body.
Scottish government should be giving money for this stuff.
Yeah,
sure.
Because this is how we're going to survive.
Yeah. But Craft Scotland do very
it's
well.
Brilliant.
Really,
it's brilliant.
Really nicely
do.
Done.
Yeah.
Because craft is now kind of like moving towards
fashionable
design.
Yeah.
You know, so they're kind of growing. I was like, because design doesn't have a policy.
But is this
a
Gross's Greener thing? Because you know, you part the National Collective. There must be lots of arts-based people, and they're up in arms about all the new, you know, competitions arm of Creative Scotland is camps and, you know, there's a whole, isn't there an uproar within our adjacent industries as well? Or, you know,
if you're talking about something that's like, what's the equivalent in craft and design to the RAAS? Probably Craft Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at what they're doing, it's like Gail was mentioning that our client was at Collect the Crafts Council's exhibition in London,
mm-hmm.
and I went to it, and the Craft Scotland display was really good. They took it really seriously. Grass Studio did the architects. What was interesting was they had architects working with them, so they designed the stands, and it was really good. Like, it was just taken really seriously, and yeah, and that was alongside national representations. I mean, it's a bonkers massive exhibition, but you know, there was a pavilion from Japan, but the Scottish representation was really strong, and it was really strongly branded. You know, you knew what it was.
Talking of branding though, Helen, do you think that, so the new chapter is, you know, it's live, it hit the press, it's been in BD, the sort of move. So it's almost like this velvet revolution has happened, but the moment hasn't been named anything. It's like the most, more soft.
Well, I'm worried about
thing.
The momentum. You know, I'm worried about
but
what's
is it
next?
Is it known?
I guess the unconventional.
Because it's out. I mean, I was chatting to somebody, they said, oh, but I work with somebody who's a brother of that. I'm like, oh shit, but what if that part, you know, is that, but it was, it's in the press actually.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually something that people know about, that there is structural shifts going on and deep amounts of talks and whatever. But it needs
but
to
there
it
are
needs
some
name
practices that
moment.
Are saying you mustn't get involved to their stuff.
Really?
But I think if you create an architectural alliance, then, as you're saying, then it starts to create a different sort of momentum.
Because it's done a lot of good work already, and I think there's a lot of momentum gains and things that are happening now that, you know, a year ago you wouldn't believe were happening. So despite maybe a change in pace, it's still progress-wise, there's been more movement in the last 12 months probably than the last 5 years. You know, you've got to look at the bigger picture.
Well, we need a president elected by the membership. That would be crucial step for me, would be let's free up this poll.
Yeah.
It's coming.
Do you promise?
It's coming.
It's
our film.
Julie says it's coming.
And it's also hopefully not just going to be
ours. Yes, thank goodness.
Just keeping an eye on time.
We need to explain to these two what that statement
means.
Look at Gail's face.
And this evening, and to kind of culminate a little bit on some of the things we've talked about. So one of the purposes of this evening is to try and help inform the 5-year RAS strategy, to kind of try to help push things in the right direction. Out of this evening, Gail asked from Andy's points, essentially things that we've discussed. Are there any key things that really stand out to people? You know, the website obviously being one of them, content and direction probably being a second, and using your allies, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
Using your allies.
Allies, yeah.
I liked Andy's statement about not curating, just giving people the structure and the framework and the space to do what the hell they want.
Mm-hmm.
Just get their message, whatever it may be, or their creative expression, whatever it may be, out there. That's so important.
I like the idea of being nimble, being fleet of foot, and actually coming together on an issues basis.
Mm-hmm.
That's very smart.
Issue by issue feels like the way to actually unlock a lot of the people's front of GDA stuff. But actually, if you call that the right thing, you can kind of arm out everything to bring some of those issues. That means that kind of thing that can dissolve some of the stasis.
The fundamental thing, not like what we're actually talking about, who in the room feels that they've had communication between us. So is it not just openness, elected members, as we're talking about? It's just we need to break that barrier down, whether that's from the outside in or us collectively getting all together and eating all the talking.
I think people need to see the point of being a member of the RIAS, the value of it. I mean, for us, for years, I've always been a member because I wanted access to practice services.
Exactly, yeah.
But it wasn't anything else.
Yeah.
But your comment earlier, who's funding things, who's lobbying for us, who's the best? What's the best organisation placed to lobby for the profession?
Yeah.
You should be that right, yeah.
And like you said earlier, okay, there's a lot of things that a lot of us are not happy with, but there's a lot of history, there's a way behind it, and there's a new name outside of this circle, the inner circle.
I think that's important, and what struck me as well is that linking the two, three presentations together, you know, we need to be bold and do some reading and nourishing the right things and restructure it, the website and the organisation, and you know, if the constitution is wrong, if the legal agreement is wrong, go and change it and make it right for us. And we need to do that. You know, I've just redone ECAM's constitution. I'm about to redo Scottish Solar Energy Group's one as well. You know, because they're 20 years old, they need to be looked at. And these things happen. And whilst we look at the website and how it communicates and how it's structured, how it talks to different parts of the profession or clients or whatever, to the wider community, we need to look at that structure inside the RAS as well, and how it's run, how it then creates this alliance support group. So I think structurally we need a really critical look and not be, you know, not go around the edges.
You could almost start with a website.
Yeah, get a really good website for the architects, like get these both three together.
Yeah, just like Neva Nell's kind of business has changed because of her website thing, you know, start with how we're looking to the outside world, and then, okay, so, yeah, are you an architect or are you general public? How do we address that and work your way down from that? I mean, actually, starting with the website gives you a nice, fun bit to start with, and then you start...
I think it would throw up so many. I mean, it would throw up so many questions.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm already sitting here. I a lot of the time I've no idea what I'm just talking about. You know, I still I'm
that's
not
what
quite
it means.
Sure. I'm still not quite sure what y'all want. Yeah. You know, I'm I mean, obviously I do, but I don't. You know, and we would have to.
We'd have to maybe know your client was as well.
Yes, exactly.